Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to ASALH's Black History Month Festival for 2021 and today's special event, our first annual ASALH Book Prize. This program is made possible by our legacy sponsors, and we would like to extend a special thank you to them for their support. Leading off today's special program will be our very own national president, Dr. Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham.
Hello, I'm Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham, the national president of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. It is my honor to bring greetings on behalf of ASALH during Black History Month. Each year, the question is asked, why does Black History Month occur in February? The relevance of February goes back to 1926, when ASALH's founder, Dr. Carter G. Woodson, the father of Black history, first established Negro History Week during the second week of February. And why that week? Because it encompassed the birthdays of Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass, both men being great American symbols of freedom. However, Woodson never confined Negro history to a week. His life's work and the mission of ASALH since its founding in 1915 represent a living testimony to the year round and year after year study of African American history. The genius of Dr. Woodson could be seen in his prolific scholarship and in his mentorship of younger scholars. His genius could also be seen in innovative popular programming, such as Negro History Week, for African Americans of all ages and all walks of life. The week provided a special time for us to collectively celebrate our racial pride, as well as collectively assess, critique white America's commitment to its professed ideals of freedom. Black teachers in segregated public elementary and secondary schools engaged their students in an array of festivities, plays, pageants, reciting speeches, essay contests, concerts, and other events. Negro History Week included yet another tradition, an annual fundraising banquet attended by ASALH's adult members, who listened to inspiring speeches on the role of knowledge in the ongoing struggle for racial equality. It is no wonder that the NAACP conferred its highest medal, the Spingarn Medal, on Carter G. Woodson in 1926, after he launched Negro History Week that very same year. Today, in the 21st century, we celebrate Black History Month, and ASALH remains faithful to Woodson's legacy of excellent scholarship and innovative programming, such as our virtual Black History Month Festival, which represents the 95th anniversary of ASALH's celebration of Black history in February. And not only is our virtual celebration of African-American life and history innovative, ASALH has for the first time established a book prize to be awarded at our festival. We see the inauguration of the ASALH Book Prize as an extension of Woodson's vision, and thus we honor excellent scholarship in Black History Month. Please join my ASALH colleagues, LaShawn Harris and Jarvis Givens, as they announce the winner of this exciting new initiative.
But first, join us in a rendition of the Negro National Anthem as performed by the Norfolk State University Mass Choir, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Thank you.
Please welcome the co-chairs of the ASALH Book Prize Committee, Dr. LaShawn Harris and Dr. Jarvis Givens.
Greetings. My name is LaShawn Harris, and I teach at Michigan State University. I'm a proud ASALH Life member and have the pleasure and distinction of serving on the ASALH Book Prize Committee.
And I'm Jarvis Givens, an assistant professor at Harvard University, and I'm also a proud life member of ASALH, and I had the honor of serving as co-chair of the ASALH Book Prize Committee along with Professor Harris. So to give a little bit of context, the ASALH Book Prize grew out of a conversation that the ASALH Executive Council had in June of 2019. And subsequently, the council decided to award an annual prize to recognize an outstanding book in the field of African-American history and culture beginning this February, 2021. As the founders of Black History Month, it seemed appropriate for ASALH's annual book prize to be associated with this important time of year. A call for submissions went out in spring 2020, and the selection committee, comprised of five ASALH members on faculty at various universities, received over 60 eligible books, all of which engaged archival sources while representing many disciplinary and interdisciplinary orientations.
In broad terms, the ASALH Book Prize Committee is interested in books that model rigorous approaches to the field, that have clear implications on how we teach and represent aspects of African-American history and culture, that have the capacity to introduce important aspects of African-American experiences to broad audiences, that use sharp analysis of Black history that boldly speak to the contemporary moment, that engage new and underutilized archives, and that use particular experiences in Black history and culture to illuminate universal aspects of the human experience.
And so there were five finalists for the book prize, which were announced last month in January. And now we are excited to reveal the inaugural winner of the ASALH Book Prize as part of ASALH's Black History Month virtual festival.
We are now pleased to have Dr. Kelly Carter-Jackson, ASALH Book Prize Committee Juror, to introduce this year's winner.
Greetings, ASALH community. I am pleased to be able to announce the first annual ASALH Book Prize to recognize an outstanding book in the field of African American history and culture. But before I begin, I would like to thank my esteemed fellow jurors, Dr. Eula Taylor, Dr. Gerald Horn, Dr. Chris Tenson, and Dr. Elizabeth Todd Breland. Together, we read over 60 submissions across disciplinary and interdisciplinary boundaries. We were particularly interested in the books that model rigorous, imaginative approaches to the field. We were honored to read books that were beautifully written and even changed how we might teach a course or create a syllabus. Many of the books either introduced us to new ideas or underutilized archives, or expanded upon old arguments in need of updating. These books use sharp analysis of African-American history and culture to speak boldly to the contemporary moment. Needless to say, it was no easy feat selecting who would be our inaugural award winner. We remain grateful, indeed indebted, to all of the authors who worked tirelessly for years to bring us their scholarship. Thank you. Now, without further ado, the winner of this year's ASALH Book Prize goes to From Here to Equality, Reparations for Black Americans in the 21st Century by authors William A. Darity and A. Kirsten Mullen. From Here to Equality is a book of sophistication, clarity, and a rich contribution to the field of African-American history. Some books inform, other books instruct. This book does both. It is a book of history and policy. We know that racism and discrimination have choked economic opportunity for African-Americans at nearly every turn. Economic data indicates that for every dollar the average white household possesses in wealth, the average Black household possesses a mere 10 cents. This is not a mistake. Darity and Mullen eloquently argue that the realities of racial inequities must be rectified. In this six-part book, Darity and Mullen take up an important issue of reparations. And their book is likely the most thoughtful, well-considered volume on reparations yet to be penned. The fact that one author is an economist and the other is a creative writer brings a unique multidisciplinary perspective to the topic. The text engages history, public policy, economics, sociology, and so much more. The questions raised by the authors will no doubt transform the reparation movement in surprising ways. For years, the quest for reparations was rendered impossible. But now experts are asking, how would you do it? We have shifted from a challenge of legitimacy to a challenge of logistics. On an intellectual level, Darity and Mullen have comprised a brilliant opus. But on an emotional level, they have given readers hope that change is possible and practical. Reparations can move us from here to equality. A hearty congratulations to our award-winning authors, William Darity and A. Kirsten Mullen. You are making our ancestors proud. And a deep thanks to our finalists and nominees. We remain grateful and confident that the work of liberation, equality, and justice is being written every single day. Thank you and congratulations again.
Thank you to the Association for the Study of African American Life and History for selecting From Here to Equality, Reparations for Black Americans in the 21st Century to receive the organization's inaugural book prize. More than a decade ago, when the association met in Raleigh, North Carolina, we presented elements of what would eventually become the case for African American reparations that we build in From Here to Equality. Dr. Mary Frances Berry, the author of The Essential, My Face is Black is True, provided critical analysis and suggestions and the confidence that we were on the right path. We are grateful to our families for their love and support. We also want to thank especially the University of North Carolina Press, Sean Hunter, who commissioned the book, our editors, David Perry and Joe Parson, who cheered on the Twitter account holder among us, and Mark Simpson Voss, who shepherded the manuscript to completion. From Here to Equality is informed by the scholarship of many, many interlocutors. Some of those eyewitness accounts, like those of South Carolina-born Sarah Grimke and Angelina Grimke Weld, radical abolitionists who provided detailed descriptions of the callous disregard given to Black lives during the antebellum period, are available only in archival collections. We also include lessons we learned from living witnesses like oral historian Kelly Elaine Navies, who is conducting research on her maternal great-grandmother, Elizabeth Goodger Stevens, born about 1850.
We have made a commitment in the pages of political equality to resuscitate and restore the accurate narrative of American history that has been preserved and sustained by African American scholars. And here we would include in particular, as being of particular significance, W.E.B. Du Bois, Lorenzo Green, and of course, Carter G. Woodson, the founder of the Association for African American Life and History. We have been very concerned about addressing misperceptions that many Americans hold about reparations, misperceptions that lead them to be opposed to reparations. And there are two categories of misperceptions that lie at the heart of what we do in From Here to Equality. The first category concerns misperceptions about the reasons why we have high levels of racial wealth inequality and racial economic inequality in the United States. The standard belief that is possessed by many Americans is that those kinds of disparities are a consequence of Black dysfunctional behavior or poor decision-making on the part of Black Americans. We argue instead in the pages of From Here to Equality that the racial wealth gap in particular is a consequence of systematic and sustained American policy that has created a chasm in wealth between Black and white households. The second set of misperceptions that we address in the pages of From Here to Equality are misperceptions that concern the historical record with respect to slavery, the period of the Civil War, and the Reconstruction era. We challenge the constructed story of those periods of time that have been that has been established by organizations like the Daughters of the American Revolution and the United Daughters of the Confederacy. And we return to a more accurate record of what actually did occur. And indeed, in the pages of From Here to Equality, we also make a case for reparations that is not limited to the atrocities of slavery. We indicate that the case for reparations, reparations for Black American descendants of US slavery, must be made on the basis of three phases of American history. The first phase is, of course, slavery itself, because that's the crucible that framed white supremacy in the United States. But the second phase, and a phase that actually lasted longer in the context of the chronology of the existence of the United States, was nearly a century of legal segregation, or the Jim Crow period, that was accompanied by waves of white massacres, up to about 100 of them, that took place both north and south and east and west, and involved extensive murders of Black Americans, but also involved the destruction and frequently the appropriation of Black property by the white terrorists. And then there's, of course, a third phase that's relevant to the case, which is the period after the passage of the civil rights legislation, where we still encounter atrocities in the form of mass incarceration, police executions of unarmed Blacks, discrimination in employment, credit, and housing markets, and most significant from the standpoint of the argument that we make in From Here to Equality, the immense gulf in wealth between Blacks and whites, a gulf in wealth that amounts to $850,000 on average between each Black and white household. This net worth differential corresponds to a situation where Black Americans constitute about 13% of the nation's population, but only possess about 2% of the nation's wealth. And we pose reparations as a mechanism for correcting that imbalance. Reparations should produce a circumstance where the Black share of wealth in the United States corresponds to the Black share of the nation's population.
We'd like to identify three essential components of a true reparations plan. The first of those is eligibility. So who are the eligible recipients? So the case that we advance in From Here to Equality is two criteria for Black reparations eligibility. First, an individual must establish that they have at least one ancestor who was enslaved in the United States. Second, an individual must demonstrate that they have self-identified as Black, African-American, Negro, or Afro-American on an official document, perhaps making public their race report, race identity on a US Census document for at least 12 years prior to the creation of a study commission for reparations or the enactment of a reparations program, whichever comes first. In short, the reparations plan that we are putting forward designates Black American descendants of US slavery as the target community. So, and the amount, you know, how much should the reparations bill be? Sandy spoke of the racial wealth gap. We absolutely view the elimination of this Black-white racial wealth gap of approximately now $850,000 per household as the target, one of the primary targets of true reparations. The culpable party is the US government, and we believe that Congress should approve a national program of reparations. So distribution in the forms of direct payments, we think, is the strategy that should be taken. In our studies of successful reparations plans in the US and around the world, this is precisely what happened. One of the examples that are known to many of us is that of the Holocaust victims who received direct payments from the Republic of Germany. This has been, an ongoing process. And, there are individuals who are currently receiving, Jews who are currently receiving reparations from Germany and also from the US, actually, as a consequence of their victimization during the Holocaust. And in the United States specifically, Japanese Americans who were wrongfully interned during World War II were awarded restitution directly. Individuals were awarded restitution beginning with legislation in 1988. More recently, in the case of the 9/11 attacks, Congress made the decision to make direct payments of restitution to the victims and to their families. And this was the case even though the United States wasn't the perpetrator. So we have some excellent examples of direct payments being given to the victims and their families. And reparations for Black American descendants of US slavery is another case that should follow that same strategy.
We focus on the wealth gap in particular because it is the best indicator or index of the cumulative intergenerational effects of white supremacy in the United States. About 30 years ago, I think, we started the process of working on the case for reparations for Black American descendants of US slavery. And it was at that point that we decided that we would commit ourselves to rigorous scholarship in advocacy of reparations. What's significant about that commitment is the fact that we recognized even at that point in time that the odds of reparations actually being adopted in the United States was actually relatively low. But our position was that if we had been living in 1810 in the United States and had the view that slavery was something that was probably going to last forever, we still hope that we would have been engaged in the process of resisting such an oppressive state of affairs. And so in the present moment, we decided that even if the odds looked long with respect to the adoption of reparations, because it's the right thing to do, it's also the right thing to pursue actively. And I will note that in the present moment, we actually do have a sense that there's a greater opportunity for reparations to be taken seriously in the United States, perhaps the greatest opportunity since the Reconstruction era. We note that, and we note this in From Here to Equality, that in the interval 2000 through 2001 or so, when Ravana Popoff and Michael Dawson did a study on American attitudes towards reparations, only about 4% of white Americans endorsed reparations. But as of approximately 2 years ago, that percentage had risen to 15%. Today, in the aftermath of the pandemic, and in the aftermath of the highly visible murder of George Floyd by the police, it looks like the estimates are closer to 30% of white Americans. So the needle is moving in the right direction. And this suggests that there is a real opportunity to make reparations happen. From our perspective, this is a debt that has been owed for 155 years since the formerly enslaved were denied the 40 acres land grants that they were promised as restitution for their years of bondage. That 155-year-old debt is long overdue. And so we've written From Here to Equality to help provide a springboard for meeting that national obligation.
Thank you, Ms. Mullen and Mr. Darity. Now please enjoy the sounds of the Alcorn State University Choir performing To Sit and Dream, arranged by R. Powell Dunn. I'd like to thank our sponsors for today's event, our legacy sponsors, the History Channel, AARP, Bank of America, Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, Omega Life Membership Foundation, New York Life, and Johnson & Johnson, our cultural sponsors, TD Ready Commitment, and Merck, and our History Maker sponsors, Fort Myer Construction, and United Bank. Please be sure to join us for our upcoming programs. On Saturday, February the 20th, we will have our marquee event, Finding Our Roots in African American History, a conversation with Dr. Henry Louis Gates Jr. and our very own national president, Dr. Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham. The host will be popular Sirius XM radio personality Joe Madison, along with activist and religious leader Reverend William Lamar, who will continue the luncheon's invocation tradition. On Wednesday, February 24th, join us for Diving with a Purpose, Recovering and Reexamining Our Roots, featuring archaeologists Justin Donovan and Alexandra Jones, scuba divers Kamu Siddiqui and Rick Powell, and curator Mary Elliott. On Sunday, February 28th, join us for our Prince George's County, Maryland Truth Branch and Maple Springs Baptist Church of D.C. Cultural Education Experience Ministry host The Black Family and Education, featuring educator Charlene Dukes. And finally, join us for our closing event, ASALH and PBS Books Presents a Conversation with Ngugi Thiong'o, Nubia Kai, and Dr. Sundiata Keita Shajua, The Perfect Nine, The Epic of Gikuyu and Mumbai, and The Black Family. Throughout the festival, music from the Black Experience, including Lift Every Voice and Sing, performed by choirs and troops from historically Black colleges and universities that will punctuate each program. For more information on how you can be a part of these virtual events, log on to our website, www.asalh.org, or check out our Black History Month Virtual Festival Facebook page, or follow our Twitter feed at #ASALH, or call us at 202-238-5910. We look forward to celebrating our Black History Month Virtual Festival with you in 2021.